Good afternoon, everybody. So we have instruction course. Welcome to the instruction course, course number IC91, titled Surgery for Primary Congenital Glaucoma, Contemporary Techniques and Recent Advances. Devasis, can you put that slide, your slide for the speakers? Before that, we speak for the instruction course, we have keynote address, Dr. Devasis will introduce, but before that, let me introduce the speakers. Myself, Dr. Mandal, working in L.V. Prasad Eye Institute for the last 31 years. My specific interest is for glaucoma, particularly pediatric glaucoma. Dr. Sati Ballabh Badekare is our consultant. She did fellowship here and then did consultancy, joined as a consultant for several years. Recently, she decided to relocate to her own city of Bangalore. Welcome, Sati. Hope you are enjoying.
Yes.
So, Devasis is in Calcutta, consultant in Center for Sight, and doing excellent job doing glaucoma practice and management of pediatric glaucoma. Sirisa Senthil, Dr. Sirisa Senthil will join later on, is our head of the department of glaucoma in L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, Hyderabad, Kar campus. And she initially got her training from Arvind Eye Care System and was in practice for some time, then joined L.V. Prasad, and she is now head of the service of glaucoma. So with this introduction, I'll request Dr. Devasis Chakraborty to introduce the keynote speaker for today.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Slide. So, thank you, sir, for your kind introduction. So, we have a keynote speaker today, Dr. John Fingert. So, Dr. Fingert's education includes undergraduate and engineering degrees at Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire. He completed an ophthalmology residency and also molecular ophthalmology and glaucoma fellowships at the University of Iowa in Iowa City. And he became the director of the Iowa Glaucoma Center in 2015. And was awarded the Hadley Carver Chair in Glaucoma in 2017. So over to you, Dr. Fingert, for your speech.
Sir, actually, Dr. John has not joined yet, sir.
Okay, is there any recorded version of his speech?
No, sir.
Okay, then shall we start our session?
Yes, sir. Let's start with the session. As and when he comes in, we'll let him speak either at the end of the session or we can insert him somewhere in the middle.
All right. So, Devasis, you start, please.
Sir.
Dr. Devasis Chakraborty will be introducing the subject and clinical evaluation, clinical feature, differential diagnosis, diagnostic evaluation for a suspected case of primary congenital glaucoma. Over to you, Devasis.
Thank you, sir.
You'll also see a timer punched in for 10 minutes.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay. So we will start. So the first topic in this session will be the clinical features and evaluation of primary congenital glaucoma. So this session is on the surgical management of primary congenital glaucoma. But before that, we have to diagnose the disease entity properly, and particularly there are some mimics of congenital glaucoma which must be excluded. So it's very important to understand that prompt diagnosis of childhood glaucoma and appropriate treatment can minimize the degree of visual impairment, because this child has to live with this vision for his or her life. And also we should keep in mind that a child should not be labeled as having glaucoma or subjected to surgical treatment unless one is reasonably sure of the diagnosis and has excluded other conditions that mimic glaucoma. Over this course, we'll find there are several disease entities which can mimic a case of primary congenital glaucoma. Now, childhood glaucoma is IOP-related damage to the eye, of course, and the IOP measurement in infants and young children, especially during UA, can potentially be affected by many factors. So whenever we are measuring the IOP, it may not reflect the actual IOP. There are other factors. That is why other signs of glaucoma in this age group, such as ocular enlargement, Hub's tri, and increased cup disc ratio, and progressive increase in the axial length, they are more important. Now, the classification of the childhood glaucomas by the Collaborative Glaucoma Research Network is into primary childhood glaucomas and the secondary childhood glaucomas. The primary childhood glaucomas include the primary congenital glaucoma, which we'll be discussing today. Apart from that, we have the juvenile open-angle glaucoma in older age, and there can be glaucomas associated with the secondary glaucomas. This can be non-acquired anomalies like Axenfeld-Rieger and Peters, non-acquired systemic disease, example Downs or Sturge-Weber, acquired conditions, for example, uveitis, steroid induced, or glaucoma following cataract surgery. Now, primary congenital glaucoma out of these is the most common form of developmental glaucoma. The basic pathology is isolated maldevelopment of the trabecular meshwork, also called isolated trabecular dysgenesis, and it is not associated with other developmental ocular anomalies or ocular diseases that raise the IOP. So while we are trying to evaluate a child with congenital glaucoma, what are our aims? First of all, is to confirm the diagnosis that it is indeed a case of PCG. Number two, to exclude secondary developmental glaucoma. Number three, to establish the baseline parameters for this child. Number four, to assess the severity and prognosis of the disease. Number five, to assess any ocular and systemic comorbidities. And number six, to rule out any space occupations that mimic glaucoma. Regarding the history, some of the important practical points are, number one, the age of onset of symptoms or signs. The common features, clinical features are epiphora without discharge, photophobia, blepharospasm, corneal haze or opacification. Rarely it can mimic a red eye. And you should also inquire about some of the pertinent history like rubella during pregnancy, use of forceps, family history, for example, parental consanguinity. This is very important in certain parts of our country, and glaucoma in siblings. Now, what are the primary symptoms of primary congenital glaucoma? Most Western textbooks describe a classical triad of epiphora, photophobia, and blepharospasm. However, in several studies done in India, the primary features are large eyeball size and hazy eyes from corneal edema, because the type of glaucoma we see here is more advanced. Dr. Mandal reported this case series of acute corneal hydrops in children with primary infantile glaucoma, where these children can present with acute hydrops, sudden onset of haziness of the cornea. Now, the visual assessment has to be done and age-appropriate methods have to be adopted. So in a small child, we have to check the fixation, whereas with older children, we have to test with the specific optotypes. Then comes the most important thing, that is the examination under anesthesia, where we have to find out the refractive status, the corneal findings, intraocular pressure, gonioscopy, ophthalmoscopy, and more importantly, decision of surgery. In many cases, UA and surgery are planned together. Now, what are the requisites for UA? A pediatric speculum is needed, then Ringer lactate or normal saline or BSS, calipers to measure the corneal diameter, appropriate tonometer, ophthalmoscope, retinoscope, gonio lens, and B-scan and tachymetry. Now, regarding the choice of the anesthetic agent, the type of anesthesia and the type of tonometer are important. In general, all anesthetics and sedative agents lower the intraocular pressure, excepting ketamine, chloral hydrate, and benzodiazepines. Sevoflurane is the most commonly used inhaled agent due to its convenience and safety profile. And the IOP, importantly, should be recorded the moment the child stops moving after inhaled anesthesia and prior to intubation, because intubation will cause a false rise in the intraocular pressure. And the normal IOP in an infant is slightly lower than in an adult, but on an average, 10 to 21 millimeter of mercury is the standard. Now, the intraocular pressure can be assessed by various equipments. So Goldman Appellation Tonometer and Parkins are the gold standard. So while in UA, we commonly use the Parkins tonometer, the other alternatives are the Tonopen, and the eye care tonometer is now recently used in many centers. It is a portable rebound tonometer, which does not need topical anesthesia. And very importantly, as soon as possible, the IOP should be checked after the initiation of the inhalation anesthesia and prior to intubation. Sorry, the slide is. Right. So the corneal haze is representative of the severity. Usually it is more in center, and we have to check the pupillary margin, the iris details and the fundus details to assess the extent of the corneal edema. Initially, the corneal edema is simple epithelial edema, and subsequently when the IOP rises, it can cause permanent stromal edema and even corneal scarring. The corneal diameter has to be assessed. So the horizontal visible corneal diameter is measured with the caliper. The normal finding is it is about 9.5 to 10.5 millimeter at birth, and if it is more than 11 millimeter in the newborn child, more than 12 millimeter in a child 1 year of age, or more than 13 millimeter at any age, then it is highly suspicious. The corneal striae has to be carefully looked at. The hub striae are usually concentric to limbus in the periphery, and in the center they are more typically horizontal. And this has to be differentiated from the hub striae that the striae that can arise because of forceps injury. So they are usually vertical, unilateral, and central. Now, regarding the fundus is evaluated by the binocular indirect ophthalmoscopy. A cup disc ratio more than 0.3 in an infant or more than 0.5 in an older child is suspicious. We should also look carefully at the retina. The pachymetry can influence the accuracy of the Goldman Applanation tonometer. However, CGRN recommends that the CCT should not be used to adjust an IOP measurement, but it should rather be taken into consideration in the overall context of this child. Axial length is very important. Absolute value may not be important, and it usually decreases after surgery. But if the axial length is progressively increasing, even after surgery, then we might suspect that the glaucoma is indeed progressing. B scan is important because if the cornea is hazy, we have to evaluate the posterior segment. There can be evidence of optic nerve cupping, and very important to rule out space occupying lesions like retinoblastoma. Gonioscopy may be difficult prior to surgery. It should be performed whenever the view allows us. So it can be done by the gonioscope, like the Coppel lens. And what are the characteristic findings in primary congenital glaucoma? In the normal newborn eye, the iris has recessed beyond the scleral spar. So the scleral spar is visible as a whitish band. Whereas in contrast, in primary congenital glaucoma, the peripheral iris inserts to the trabecular meshwork and the scleral spar is not visualized. Then, the confirmation of these findings is done during the UA. So we have to confirm PCG by the corneal edema, hub striae, and the corneal diameter, increase in the intraocular pressure, exclude glaucoma other than primary congenital glaucoma, and exclude non-glaucomatous conditions mimicking glaucoma. Yeah, thank you. So that is the end of this presentation, the clinical features and the assessment of a child with pediatric glaucoma. And the second speaker will be Dr. Swati, and she will be discussing on the mimics of congenital glaucoma. Over to you, sir, for introducing Dr. Swati.
We have introduced Sati. Sati, you can start your presentation. In the meantime, just for information, Juby, the moment our keynote speaker comes in, we can accommodate the talk in between.
Sure, sir. Okay.
All right. Sati, please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon. So I'll be talking today on the mimickers of primary congenital glaucoma. At the outset, I would like to state that there are no financial disclosures, and the images and the cases I'm presenting today are from LV Prasada Institute, Hyderabad, and mostly from Dr. Mandal, but wherever it is not, I have duly acknowledged the same. So the objectives of my talk today would be to enlist the different mimickers of primary congenital glaucoma. And I'll quickly present about four clinical case scenarios of the common mimickers. So Dr. Debashish has already alluded to the signs and symptoms of congenital glaucoma very nicely. So let us go by each sign and see what all can mimic that particular sign. So the most common presentation of congenital glaucoma, at least in the Indian population, is corneal haze. Corneal haze, we all know corneal opacity in a child goes by the mnemonic stumped, the entities comprising the mnemonic stumped, which is sclerocornea, trauma, ulcer, mucopolysaccharidosis, congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy, and dermoid. Of these, the most common is shed. The next would be the Hab's striae. The Descemet membrane tears we see in PCG can also be seen in birth trauma. I'll be coming to how we can differentiate between the two. Buphthalmos can also be seen in congenital megalocornea, keratoglobus, and high myopia. Optic disc cupping or a pale disc or a suspicious glaucomatous disc can be seen in hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, and physiological cupping in children is a great mimicker of congenital glaucoma. So now let us not forget that an increase in IOP can also be due to a faulty calibration of the tonometer, tonometry which is not done using the correct technique, and when children are not able to cooperate for the examination. So we need to keep this in mind before we rush on to a diagnosis. So let us see the commonly seen cases which mimic congenital glaucoma. The first case is of a 6-month-old boy who was brought to us with increase in the size of the eyes, both the eyes, since birth. There was no other complaint. And the parents in fact said his visual milestones were normal. The father as well as the maternal grandfather had similar complaints, that is, they also had big eyes, but they were doing well vision-wise and eye-wise. So when we examined, the corneal diameter was 15 millimeters in both the eyes. The axial length was appropriate for age, and the IOP in both the eyes by Perkins tonometer was 10 millimeters of mercury. The rest of the anterior and the posterior segment was normal. So we came to a diagnosis of congenital megalocornea. This is because the IOP was normal, the cornea was clear, the axial length was normal, and the optic disc was normal. The only overlapping feature, I would say, was the high corneal diameter, the increase in corneal diameter. Also, we need to keep in mind that the congenital megalocornea is an X-linked recessive disease. That means the male family members tend to have this, and it is a non-progressive disease. However simple it is to diagnose this condition, we should always follow the child up maybe 3 to 4 monthly once, at least for a year, just to be sure that we are not missing out on glaucoma. The second case is very interesting. It was a 3-year-old boy who came to us with clouding of the left eye since birth. There was no other symptoms, no significant family history. This person was, the baby was referred to us by the treating pediatrician as a case of left congenital glaucoma. This is actually Dr. Mandal's case. So in this, when we examined the case, we found that the right eye was absolutely normal. The left eye, the corneal diameter, and the IOP was normal. What we found that was that the corneal edema and the striae were vertical in this case. So when we probed further, the parents told us that the delivery was assisted by forceps. So this was a case of birth trauma. When we observed the child, and after 6 weeks, this was the clinical picture. This was another child who presented to us with birth trauma, but in the right eye. So when we look at the two conditions, we need to differentiate between the striae in these two conditions. The half striae in congenital glaucoma, like Dr. Debashish mentioned, is horizontal and linear when they are central, and they are parallel or curvilinear to the limbus when they are more peripheral. In contrast to it, the striae in the birth trauma, that is the forceps trauma, is vertical and linear. This is because during the delivery, when they insert the forceps, the blade slips over the inferior orbital rim and they compress the globe vertically, leaving a vertical scar. Also, this is more common in the left eye because the left occipital anterior is the most common fetal presentation. One important feature we need to keep in mind is that the half striae is uncommon in corneas less than 12.5 millimeters of millimeters or in diameter. So moving on to the third case, this was a 9-year-old girl who presented to us with clouding of the black portion of the eye since birth, and she was not able to see things clearly. The elder sister had a similar problem, and the parents had a consanguineous marriage. So this was the clinical picture. We see that there is a diffuse corneal haze in both the eyes. However, the corneal diameter is normal. The fundus was very hazily seen and the disc was normal. The axial length is normal. The two abnormal features were the corneal thickness was extremely high. It was more than 1,000 microns. And the IOP in the right eye was 23 millimeters of mercury, whereas in the left eye was 25 millimeters of mercury by GAT. So based on the features, we came to a diagnosis of congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy. So we need to keep in mind that in SHED, the corneal diameter is usually normal. The edema is very severe. The case I am presenting now has a very, the edema is still less, but usually they present with severe edema. Half stray is absent, but because of the corneal edema, we may not be able to appreciate that. Again, the disc is usually healthy. Because of the corneal edema, it may not be visible. The two things which again will be abnormal are the high CCT, which can make the IOP also high. But what poses as a bigger challenge is that these cases may coexist with glaucoma, in which case we'll have to take a call. But we need to keep in mind these other features of glaucoma, like increase in axial length, corneal diameter, before we rule out congenital glaucoma totally. The fourth case is of a six-month-old boy who presented with whitish discoloration of the black portion since one day, with a history of watering in both eyes since 5 days. There was no significant family history, and the maternal and birth history were not significant. So this is a representative photo. I don't have the actual photo. The left eye of this patient had diffuse corneal edema with DM folds. The corneal diameter was normal, that is 11 millimeters. And the IOP by Perkins was 16 millimeters in the right eye, and in the left eye it was 10 millimeters. The right eye was completely normal except for the inferior corneal edema. The left eye fundus was not visible due to the corneal edema. So when we asked, probe a little more into the history, the parent said that there was a history of exposure to the sap of calotropis tree. So this was a case of toxic keratopathy. So in these cases, there is a clear-cut exposure to the chemical, and all the other parameters are usually normal except for the corneal edema. So the take-home message from my presentation today that is that a variety of conditions can mimic congenital glaucoma, and these, because it is a child, as such, examining the child is very difficult. And when these conditions mimic each other, it becomes a real challenge to us. A detailed history and importance to subtle clinical features can help us in differentiating the conditions from congenital glaucoma. And always, as always, a meticulous follow-up is very important in all these cases. Thank you.
Thank you, Sati, for a nice presentation. The stage is set for discussing about the surgical management. Thank you, Sati. So guest speaker, whenever I am requesting Juby, once he joins, we can accommodate him. So let me present my part. Just can come. All right, Devasis, is this slide visible?
Sir, yes, perfect.
All right. So, learning objectives of this presentation is to understand the surgical options for primary congenital glaucoma, the surgical technique, and the long-term results of the surgical technique. Advances in diagnosis, investigation, anesthetic technique, medical and surgical treatment has really improved the prognosis of patients with primary congenital glaucoma. Now, congenital glaucoma is a surgical disease. Medical therapy is accorded a supportive role to reduce the intraocular pressure temporarily, to clear cornea, and to facilitate surgical intervention. The options as a primary procedure available to us are listed in this slide. The first surgical technique described was goniotomy in 1940s by Barkan, but it requires clear cornea. And that's the reason alternative technique of trabeculotomy ab externo is important. Primary trabeculectomy is not the primary surgery, but combined trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy in our Indian setup is the most important surgical technique. I'll come to it in detail. just to talk about goniotomy. With a needle-like knife under microscopic control with the help of a surgical gonioprism, the needle is introduced through limbus and the incision is given at the angle so that the root of the iris falls back, as you see here, and the Schlemm's canal is open to the anterior chamber. But it requires clear cornea, and that's the reason trabeculotomy ab externo is important, simultaneously and independently described by Burian and Smith from two different parts of the world is an alternative technique. Trabeculotomy ab externo is anatomically more precise, technically easier, and is the microsurgery which is easy to learn comparatively, easy to learn and easy to teach. We'll explain the surgical technique of combined primary trabeculectomy and trabeculotomy. It is important in Indian context and severe form of the disease because the two components of the surgery, trabeculotomy and trabeculectomy, helps in reduction of the intraocular pressure. Let me explain the surgical technique in detail. The conjunctival flap, conjunctival tenon layer, limbus-based flap is raised, and the superficial episcleral blood vessels are cauterized. And then the most important step is to really delineate the surgical limbus under the partial thickness scleral flap. If you go from limbal side, corneal side to the posterior, the anterior most part would be peripheral cornea. And after that is the transitional zone, which is nothing but external landmark for the trabecular meshwork. And where it meets white sclera is the identification wise most important landmark and most important surgical area to explore the Schlemm's canal and the scleral spine. Now, where it is classically said, where white meets the blue, Schlemm's wait for you. That's the dictum. Once the Schlemm's canal is opened, outer wall is incised, this instrument called metal trabeculotome is introduced. Lower prong and upper one acts as a guide. Approximately 80 to 90% of the probe should be introduced into the canal, and then the probe should be rotated to really disrupt that part or that segment of the trabecular meshwork, creating a continuity between the anterior chamber and that segment of the Schlemm's canal. Once this trabeculotomy is done on one side, similar procedure is done on the other side of the radial incision. And when we complete both the sides, approximately 110 to 120 degree of the trabecular meshwork is taken care of. Next step is to do the removal of the deeper block, as you see here, and it is done in the usual way as we do trabeculectomy in adult. Approximately 3 by 2 millimeter or 3 by 1 millimeter of the tissue is removed. Peripheral iridectomy is done. The idea is to do iridectomy in a way that the base of the iridectomy should be equal or even larger than the internal ostium created, so that if shallow chamber happens in the early postoperative period, the iris pillar should not block the internal ostium. Once the trabeculotomy and trabeculectomy is done, it is necessary, it is next step is to close the partial thickness scleral flap, one at the apex, one on each side of the triangle. We used to put tenonylon suture. In my initial 10 years, this is the way I learned and this is the way we practiced. After 10 years, because I do not believe in using antifibrotic therapy in children, in the very first surgical technique, I avoided the side sutures and single suture is used at the apex to close the superficial scleral flap. The conjunctival flap, conjunctival tenon layer is closed in a continuous fashion with a round-bodied atraumatic needle using 8-O polygalactin or Vicryl suture. will come to video. The post-operative care is taken care of, antibiotic for 1 week, topical steroid tapering dosage for 6 weeks, and topical cycloplegic for 3 to 4 weeks. You can see the post-operative appearance of the bleb in a case of congenital glaucoma operated by combined trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy, and you can see the corneal clarity achieved. You can see the Hab's tie crossing below the pupillary axis, and you can see the peripheral iridectum. Let me present the video. A central radial incision is gradually deepened. Devasis, is the video seen?
Sir, the video is seen. Yes.
Devasis is not there. Devasis, yeah. Can you see the video?
Yes, sir. Video is running, sir. Video is running.
Oh, all right. Is the voice there?
Voice is not there. You have to give the commentary.
Let me say. So once the Schlemm's canal is opened, the trabeculotomy probe is introduced and is rotated. Little resistance is felt so that during the disruption of the trabecular meshwork, it will create little resistance. Too much of resistance indicate that you are creating false passage, and no resistance or very little resistance indicate that you have gone into the posterior chamber and actually perforated the iris. That is not required. So it's an experience which cannot be taught by language. It has to be felt. It has to be done. That's the way. Let me see. Let me present the video of the same child, how the corneal edema behaved with the time. Compare and contrast the appearance of the cornea at presentation and at 2 weeks, 2 months, and 6 months after the surgical technique. You can see, note the clinical appearance of the Hab's tie in this child. Now you can see how beautifully the corneal edema cleared. I'm presenting a similar case where a 3-month-old infant was brought to us in an emergency by the parents. The child is from Pune. Sudden corneal clouding. The parents felt that the child is having beautiful eye, but actually it is a manifestation of acute high drops related to infantile onset glaucoma. Now, I'll present the visual behavior of this child whose surgical technique has been presented. You can see the visual development, fixation developed, and the child is refusing to go back to mother. And from father's lap comes to me and refuses to go back to father. You can see this is the appearance of the, or the activity of the eye after the age of 6 months. So after about 3 months of surgery, this video was clicked. By this activity, you can assess the child is doing very well. His visual development is normal. Here is the child photographed at the age of 8 years when the patient came. The child is doing very well. The child is interested. I actually inspired the child to become a doctor. He's inspired. He comes, he's the topper in his class. Now, to talk about the literature, Professor Sood, my mentor, initially published his results in the year 1983, where he concluded that this surgical technique is the safest and the most effective in children with primary congenital glaucoma in India. 1994, British Journal of Ophthalmology published an editorial by O'Connor, which comments that this surgical technique may represent the next step in the search for the best surgical treatment for congenital glaucoma. We published our 15 years result, 360 children, 624 eyes, done over a period of 15 years, and we concluded that prolonged IOP control can be achieved in patients with primary developmental glaucoma, and 42% of the patients gained normal visual acuity. The updated version of our series is presented here. 1128 eyes of 653 consecutive children of congenital, infantile, and juvenile onset glaucoma operated by me over a period of 21 years, 1990 to 2010. And you can see the success rate is decreasing over a period of time, and the success rate of over 90% at the end of 2 years is reducing to 70% at the end of 10th year. Mind it, it is surgical success without any anti-glaucoma medication. Best spectacle corrected visual acuity was 27.6% normal visual acuity, and rest were having mild to moderate degree of visual impairment. Patients where primary surgery was done by us did better compared to the group where we did the second surgery, primary surgery was done elsewhere. Corneal clarity, where it is normal, did better compared to the patients where corneal edema and corneal scar was the presenting feature. Children who had congenital onset glaucoma and operated within 1 week to 1 month of birth did relatively poorer compared to the patients of infantile onset glaucoma. Here is the child. The child operated for acute eye drops. I presented the video. Here is 6 months postoperative appearance of the child. Total clearance of corneal edema has been achieved actually at the end of 2 weeks. Now, let me present some illustrative case. Simultaneous bilateral surgery was done on this child at the age of 3 weeks. 6 months postoperative appearance showed clear cornea in both eyes. Here is 3 years postoperative appearance. With the spectacle correction for myopia, the child is enjoying his appropriate normal vision. This is the child where operation was done on the third day of birth, and that this is the child where surgery was done at the youngest age of 3 days after birth. Again, simultaneous bilateral surgery was done. And you can see 6 months postoperative appearance showing total clearance of corneal edema. This child was operated at the age of 2 weeks, and you can see 6 months postoperative appearance. And you can see here the child at the age of 12 years completed 27 years of follow-up. This photograph was taken when the child completed 25 years of follow-up. The child is doing journalism and is doing job in Calcutta. Just to give yet another example where surgery was performed, simultaneous bilateral surgery was performed on this child at the age of 2 weeks. Here is 25 years postoperative appearance. The child completed chartered accountancy and practicing independently in Kolkata. Just to summarize, so here in this presentation, we have given a glimpse of the surgical options available and the most important surgical technique suitable for Indian patient population where there is significant megalocornea and corneal edema. And we will come to the next part of my presentation later on, surgical technique, recent advances on the surgical aspects of primary congenital glaucoma. Juby, is our guest speakers available or still not?
No, sir, he's still not with us.
All right, so let us continue. I cannot see Dr. Sirisa is here. Welcome, Sirisa. Hi. So all is Hello. Yours. So Dr. Sirisa, I introduced, he is our head of the service in Kar campus, had extensive experience on management of childhood glaucoma. She will be talking on management, surgical management of refractory pediatric glaucoma, particularly antifibrotic therapy and glaucoma drainage devices. Over to you, Sirisa.
Thank you, Dr. Mandal and the Bashish. I hope you're able to hear me.
Yes, madam. Yes.
Yes, you are audible.
Thank you. So from the presentations, we saw that childhood glaucoma is not uncommon in our part of the country. And when we looked at the profile of childhood glaucomas, that means if we see, let's say, 100 children with congenital or childhood glaucomas, we close to about 44% had secondary glaucoma and the rest 56% had primary glaucoma. So we do see almost equal number of secondary glaucomas as well. That includes developmental as well as the acquired glaucomas. Majority of the primary glaucomas that we see also who come to us when they are very young have a very severe disease at presentation. That is the reason why most often we do a external trabeculotomy with trabeculectomy, because the corneal haze does not allow you to do a goniotomy in these patients. So what we need to remember is when somebody presents with a very severe disease, the primary surgery works for some of them. And as time goes by, there is a decrease in the survival or the success rate for these patients. That means they will require medications and they may require surgeries in the future. So like what Dr. Mandal presented, the outcomes of combined trabeculotomy and trabeculectomy are quite good. At 1 year, they're close to about 85%, but at 6 years, they drop down to almost half of that. So close to about 57% had success at 6 years. And as time goes by beyond that, it only declines. So when we looked at our own data as to what was the percentage of patients who required resurgery, we found close to about 1/4 of all these children who required surgery in the beginning required a second procedure as well as time went by. How you define refractory glaucoma as those where a conventional glaucoma surgery does not work or those where the conventional glaucoma surgery has failed. So that is what we are looking at. So once the primary surgery fails, the second option is to start them on medical treatment. Sometimes we try to rescue the primary surgery by certain interventions. If they also do not work, we move on to trabeculectomy with anti-metabolites. And sometimes the drainage devices come to our rescue. And in very difficult cases, we end up doing a cyclodestructive procedure. So this was a child with primary congenital glaucoma. This is a representative video of a child who underwent a needling at a later time point. If you see, there was peeping of the pupil because of the peripheral anterior synechia that the eye had developed and the bleb was flat. So this child was taken up, a synecholysis of the superior synechia was done, followed by a bleb needling. So sometimes we will be able to rescue the failing bleb, and we may try and avoid doing a second intervention in the short time. So on the left hand side, you see this is both the eyes of a child. You can upper panel, you can actually see the corneal haze. You can see multiple HAP striae. The lower panel shows you both the eyes of the same child. Following needling, you can see the cornea has significantly cleared, except the HAP striae, which are persistently present. So most often they will be able to manage. Even if it means you manage this for a few years, it's still worth it because you can avoid doing a second surgical intervention. This is one more procedure that we started doing way back in 2014. Until then, goniotomy was not a procedure that we normally, if the cornea is not clear, goniotomy is not a procedure that we do as a primary procedure. But nowadays, we also see children who come in a little early. So goniotomy is definitely feasible in them, and we are doing it. In some situations, like this is a child who had a secondary glaucoma, and we can very clearly see the angle. Or even in primary congenital glaucoma, once the cornea has cleared significantly after the primary surgery, second surgery, instead of doing a trabeculectomy with mitomycin or a repeat or a tube, we can definitely do a goniotomy, because especially the inferior part, since we haven't touched that. When we looked at our success rates of goniotomy, so I'm talking about those where the primary surgery was a combined trab and trap, following which we did a goniotomy when the medical treatment failed after a few years. So in these patients, without medications, they don't do very well. Majority of them, I think close to about 56% of them achieved success. That means pressure control that did not require a second intervention with medications. So even if it means that we can try and prevent 50% of the people to go into a second procedure, I think that is still worth taking care of. If the other procedures are not easy to do or they don't succeed, then we may end up requiring to do a repeat trabeculectomy. And whenever we repeat a trabeculectomy, we most often use the antifibrotic agents. So this was a patient who actually had multiple procedures done. And after every single glaucoma surgery, it is successful. But then when the child had a keratoplasty, following which long-term steroid use and inflammation and things like that, that procedure failed. So this child required a second procedure. You can also see that there is a tube here. So despite the AGV, the child's IOP was not coming down. And we went ahead. So this is a question that is asked. Can we do a TRAB if a tube has failed? We can do it if you find the conjunctiva that is suitable enough and adequate for you to go ahead with the procedure. So this child underwent a repeat trabeculectomy in the nasal quadrant and following that procedure. So basically the amount of mitomycin that you see, concentration and the duration is 0.04% for 2 minutes, depending again upon the scleral thickness. Suppose this is a very grossly thinned out sclera, then I reduce it to 1 minute. If it is even more thin, then sometimes we can even avoid doing a mitomycin because you're worried about the toxicity of the mitomycin on the scleral tissue as well as on the conjunctiva. So this child underwent a mitomycin C trabeculectomy. Since the tenance was good and the sclera was also all right, we used it for 2 minutes. We should be very careful in choosing the number of mitomycin sponges as well as cleaning it up very well so that you don't leave behind the residual mitomycin and the rest of the procedure is similar to what we normally do. So a deep ostium, and this patient had a very, very minimal peripheral iris tissue, which was not even prolapsing out because of the previous multiple surgeries that the child had. So if you don't see the iris tissue in the area where you have done deep ostium, it's fine not to go and search for it because then you will be disturbing the anterior chamber and the conjunctival closure. So what is very important is that these eyes are, when you use mitomycin C, these eyes are prone to develop thin cystic bleb. So we have to be very, very careful in following them up. This child, I remember, because of the thin cystic bleb, pressures are very fine. The child is happy, but we are unhappy because of the bleb. So we did a lateral tarsography to prevent exposure of the thin cystic bleb. Repeat trabeculectomy success. Sometimes, depending upon the indication and things like that, success can be as high as 95%. But like I said, thin cystic blebs are an issue. So keep a watch on that. And bleb infection because of eye rubbing and recurrent upper respiratory tract infection they get, I think we need to be very, very careful. Two types of implants that we use in children are the valved and non-valved implants. We use both the adult and pediatric AGV, depending upon the size of the eye and the age of the child. And a non-valved implant, what you have is ADI. So we use them in secondary glaucoma, sometimes even as a primary procedure, or when the primary procedure has failed in primary congenital glaucomas. They differ by the immediate flow that happens in a valve design versus a delayed flow that happens in a non-valved implant. Non-valved implant is definitely much better than the valved implant. We'll come to the results a little later. I think what is very important to remember is the special problem, large eye for the orbit, a growing eyeball where the tube can actually become short in relative to the size of the eyeball, problem of eye rubbing and active immunological and hypotony chances are very high. This is a common question that is asked. So how do you choose which type of an implant to do? So to me, the answer is very simple. How fast do you want the IOP to control? Is the child likely to come back for follow-up? And what is the risk of doing a procedure in that particular eye? So all these things, I think, play a very important role before we decide. Also, the site of planning a surgery is very important. So while superotemporal is the best choice, we need to remember, depending upon how the eyeball is, we have to choose. So in this particular child, if you see this huge cephaloma, and you can see hardly any scleral tissue in the superior quadrant. So this child underwent an inferotemporal pars plana tube followed by a keratoplasty. So I think we need to choose it based on the condition of the eye as well as the where do you place the tube? Is it in the sulcus or is it in the anterior chamber or in the pars plana? Again, depending upon the condition of the anterior segment. So these are two videos that shows you the implantation of the AGV and RD. So basically the procedure is almost an external procedure where you fix the implant very well and making sure that the sutures are appropriately placed and tightly sutured. And the tube always have to be placed in a long tunnel and always try and cover it with a patch graft. So the patch graft, what I normally do is I use glue to stick the patch graft, but in children, not just the glue, I also try and suture the anterior part of the patch graft to the underlying sclera, making sure that it doesn't disturb, because eye rubbing, or however careful you are, that is one thing that we cannot completely stop from children. So we have to make sure that it doesn't displace and tube is very well covered. So these points have to be taken into account before we do the procedure in these patients. So this is the same video. This was a child who has one-eyed child who had a lensectomy done for a spirophakic dislocated lens. You can see this was, since a vitrectomized eye, I had to place the tube in the sulcus, is almost in the pars plana. So and the entire length of the tube is covered well with the patch graft. Plus also you can see, despite the glue, I'm also placing the additional sutures, and a good conjunctival closure is very important. So this was another child where the cornea is very hazy. We use either a light pipe or an endoscope to place the tube. And once you bring down the pressure, then they should be able to do a keratoplasty as well. So ultimately, we have to work hand in hand with the specialist, cornea specialist or the retina specialist, to be able to help these complex eyes. They are not without problems. So tube obstruction is a very, very serious issue, especially if it is vitreous, then that requires a vitrectomy. If it is fibrin or blood clot, they generally try and disappear. There's no problem. And tube cornea touch, like I said, long tube, try and avoid placing it. In case we need to place a long tube, try to take a sinuous course in the subconjunctival area so that even if we want to take care of a shorter tube at a later time point because of the growing eye of the child, we can still try and redirect the tube or lengthen the tube at a later time point rather than leaving it very long in the anterior chamber. Like I said, tube retraction is a problem. So if that happens, then we can use a tube extender. But most often days, what we do is we try and keep the tube parallel to the limbus. So even if it is a little longer, it's not going and troubling the central or the paracentral cornea. That's very important. So these two complications of tube erosion and implant exposure are serious issues, and we have to make sure that we prevent it at any cost. So how do they fare? They do equally well. So these are a couple of articles that have shown that both the AGV and Barwelt implant and Molteno, which is again a non-Barwelt implant, do well. Same thing we have found. So both for primary and secondary glaucomas, implants do well, at least but 1 to 2 years, the success rate is close to 80 to 90%. How do the Barwelt and non-Barwelt implant compare? They also compare quite well, but non-Barwelt implant, the advantage is the IOP reduction is so good that the number of medications required are lesser, but however, serious complications can be there in these eyes and you have to be very, very careful. But that is something that we have to take a call on. Postoperative hypertensive phase, again, is much less with ADI. Hypotonia is a serious problem in children, and developing cataract is again a serious issue. So we have to be very, very careful. Follow-up is necessary, especially in and around the time of ligature opening. So most often we take steps to prevent these complications. An ultrasound B-scan plays a very important role in the postoperative follow-up to catch a problem or a complication very early and treat them appropriately, because children are not going to allow you to do a thorough examination every time we see them. And very often we also can't do a EUA. Cyclodestructive procedures are usually done at a when the visual choice is not much, or rather the visual potential is not much. Sometimes if the risk of surgery is very high, we try and avoid doing an open surgery, and we can do a cyclodestructive procedure even in a seeing eye, but it's better to do it in a limited form. So you can repeat it if necessary, but on the other hand, if it becomes too, it becomes very difficult. So this is just a small video that shows the procedure of TSCPC. Like I said, limited TSCPC of, let's say, 18 to 20 shots. And if necessary, we can always repeat it at a later time point. So to summarize, refractory childhood glaucomas are not uncommon and they are very challenging. choose the type of surgery that is that you think is safe for the child and that you are the surgeon has an expertise with, and modify it as needed for the child. Beware of the complications, and all of this requires a lifelong and meticulous follow-up. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sirisa, for a wonderful presentation and extensively covering the subject. We'll have question answer, and may I request you to stay for some time? You are busy in the OPD. Is it okay? So let me present the later part of my talk. Devasis, is this slide visible? Devasis? Yeah. So I'll talk on this subject for a few minutes. Recent advances in the treatment of congenital glaucoma. As we discussed, that primary options are many, of which trabeculotomy, ab externo, goniotomy, and combined trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy is important in Indian context. Now, the newer surgical techniques, is now the state of the art surgical option for congenital glaucoma in US and in developed countries, are where the opportunity permits to use the microcatheter, 360 degree trabeculotomy, fiber optic microcatheter assisted trabeculotomy. Endoscopic goniotomy was tried, but it's not very popular nowadays. Now, far more recent techniques is, these two are very important, ab interno trabeculectomy using a novel dual blade device, devised by Kauk, and gonioscopy assisted transluminal trabeculotomy, GAT classically known. And this was devised, and first publication came by Dr. Devender Grover. I saw his name as one of the invited speaker, international speaker. I'm sure he must have been talking on this subject in another forum also. Anyway, now, recent advances in refractory pediatric glaucoma includes the implant, of which Barvelt and Ahmed is in use for several decades. Recently, Arvind Eye Institute developed, or I'll say is popularizing an implant called Orolab Aqueous Drainage Implant Adi. Sirisa has talked to about this problem, about this implant. Now, other non-penetrating glaucoma surgery like visco, canalostomy, deep sclerectomy is not very popular because of the very important fact that in advanced stage of the glaucoma, non-penetrating surgery simply do not reduce the level of intraocular pressure reduction the way we want in moderate to advanced stage of the disease. Probably in the very mild form of the disease, these are suitable. Other newer techniques are trabectome, stent, and hydrus implant. Cycloablative procedure, we are now doing cyclophotocoagulation with diode laser, diode cyclophotocoagulation, cyclodiode we call, and endoscopic cyclophotocoagulation in cases where we are doing some vitreoretinal surgery and you are using or taking this opportunity to do an ablation of few ciliary process to take care of the intraocular pressure in the long run. Let me just explain this GAT procedure. Sirisa is doing it, and Rasmi Krishnamurti, another consultant of our institute, is doing it. I have a video for that technique borrowed from Rasmi. I'll present that. What is used under microscopic control, under I'll say view of gonioprism, surgical gonioprism, the localized goniotomy is performed to expose the Schlemm's canal from inner aspect, that is from anterior chamber, and the microcatheter is introduced and is cannulated all 360 degree and is retrieved from the same wound created for original ab interno goniotomy. And then the two ends are cut and pulled so that internally 360 degree clavicularotomy is done. Surgically demanding, if 360 degree is not possible, maybe it will be required to retrieve or cut open the thing in 180 degree or 360 degree or 270 degree and do the procedure. This is a paper published in British Journal of Ophthalmology showing the technique. I am showing a video of technique, or the surgical technique I am describing here is described in Archives of Ophthalmology in the year 1995, nylon suture assisted trabeculotomy. You know, nylon suture is used, Schlemm's canal is opened from external aspect, I have external technique. The tip of the 6-O-proline suture is made bulbous by using cautery, heat cautery, and that is used after the viscoelastic is injected into the Schlemm's canal either side, that is used to cannulate the Schlemm's canal all around and then retrieve from the original wound. And then it is pulled to do 360 degree trabeculotomy, suture trabeculotomy. Here is the technique seen. The video is downloaded from internet. Sarkisian is the surgeon. You can see elegant surgery, but probably very surgically very demanding. You'll have to really be very expert in dissecting the Schlemm's canal and deepening the anterior chamber by using viscoelastic and then inserting the iTrack microcatheter illuminated from into one side. And you can see the illumination blinking red light here. And it is possible, at least in some percentage of cases. I do not know how easy or how difficult it is, because to my mind, it is a very surgically demanding technique. Unless you are having illuminated microcatheter with proline suture, it is more difficult. Here it is done with illuminated microcatheter. You can see here, it is going. The problem is Schlemm's canal is not just a circular tire-like thing. The trabeculae is there, there may be obstruction, but you here, it is possible to retrieve. Microcatheter has passed 360 degree, retrieved from the same wound, and then anterior chamber is deepened so that during the pull, when 360 degree trabeculotomy is done, anterior chamber should not be shallow and it should not cause any incision to the iris. You can see how beautifully the trabeculotomy is extending to complete actually 360 degree of the circumference, total circumferential trabeculotomy, ab externo technique. The technique which described by Grover later on was ab interno trabeculotomy with the microcatheter, illuminated microcatheter. I am now showing is a technique called ab interno trabeculectomy. What is done here is with a specially designed, very scientifically designed instrument called double blade goniotomy, trabeculectomy blade, actually, ab interno use. And the two sides are cutting. Here is sharp edge. It engages the trabecular meshwork in the center. Then it is engaged into the Schlemm's canal. And then the knife is forward movement of the knife is done to really remove a significant area or segment of the trabecular meshwork is really stripped off or removed. And that's the reason it is not trabeculotomy, it is trabeculectomy, ab interno. Just watch the video carefully. corneal entry wound is made with a clear incision. Viscoelastic, high viscosity viscoelastic is injected to deepen the chamber. A viscoelastic drop is put in the corneal surface, and with the help of gonioprism, you know, the instrument here is introduced, crosses the pupil, engages into the 180 degree opposite trabecular meshwork, and you can see beautifully trabecular meshwork artist diagram, and this will be introduced into the Slemp's canal so that the incision is done by the side blade, and a significant percentage of so-called trabecular meshwork, which used to be functional, not functioning because of goniodisgenesis. And you can see the aqueous humor is directly accessible to Slemp's canal, and after that post-canalicular flow takes place by the natural system. So this is the surgical technique. Here is the surgical technique described. And let me present the video I borrowed from Dr. Rashmi Krishnamurthy, one of our consultant who is doing this surgery routinely. And Sirisa is also expert in that. Any question we can ask Dr. Sirisa to really answer. Just see the video carefully. You know, surgical gonioprism is really kept very steadily over the corneal surface. Paracentesis opening is made, anterior chamber is deepened, and then the cow double blade instrument is introduced and is really engaged into the trabecular meshwork, and then the movement is done forwarded. Forward movement is done so that a significant segment trabecular meshwork is really removed, or I'll say incised, and then the other side you can do this motion, or extending other side you can join the incision here. You can see the trabecular meshwork is incised, or I'll say removed, and that is removed with the help of a forceps. Eutrata's forceps is used to remove the trabecular meshwork. You can see this trabecular meshwork, and this segment approximately 3 to 4 clock hour of the trabecular meshwork is removed directly, so that aqueous have access to the Slemp's canal, and then the post-canalicular flow or the drainage takes place. These are elegant technique getting popularized, particularly the ab interno technique of GAT technique. Kahuk's double blade is also becoming popular with time. And probably of all the technique, 360 degree suture microcatheter related assisted trabeculotomy with illuminated, with the help of illuminated microcatheter, is the most popular technique. But the problem in our country is, even when very advanced stage of glaucoma, corneal clarity permits to do ab interno technique in Caucasian or European patient population. Compared to that, a significant percentage of patients we see, probably 70 to 80% of the patients we see in India, will present like this. In addition to advanced megalocornea, advanced corneal edema, in which ab interno technique is just not possible. Ab externo probably suture trabeculotomy is still possible, but ab interno technique is not possible. And that's the reason, sort of the technique which we described in the recent advances, primary combined trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy is important. And you can see how beautifully this Slemp's canal can be exposed under a partial thickness scleral flap. I'm presenting this video just to show how beautifully this Slemp's canal can be opened from external aspect under a partial thickness triangular scleral flap. The person who is expert in GAT procedure or Couch double plane will say the same thing, how beautifully the things can be done, external, internal trabeculotomy, internal trabeculectomy, or ab interno CAT procedure. This is just to show the trabecular Slemm's canal opening and derooping of the Slemm's canal. Now, this derooping is just to show the anatomy of the Slemm's canal, nothing else. What we are doing here, if the internal wall of the trabecular meshwork or the Slemm's canal is removed, that is nothing but have internal mouth blade assisted trabeculectomy, have internal trabeculectomy. So the problem is, in a given case, even when we made an attempt to make sure that the aqueous has access to the Slemm's canal, in advanced stage of the disease or in advanced stage of the developmental anomaly, how is the post canalicular outflow system developed? We have no idea. There is no way we can really assess clinically. And that's the reason combined trabeculotomy, trabeculectomy has an advantage over the technique. Just to show you the same technique, we are exceeding time probably. Just for the sake of showing this surgical technique once again, I'm presenting this. We are all right because our guest speaker is probably not available and time is up. And I'm still presenting this video because anyway, there is nothing. We had time up to 2:25. I'm just forwarding the thing. Just to show how beautifully this Slemm's canal can be identified. The most important step of trabeculotomy technique is central radial incision is gradually deepened across the scleral spur to really incise the superficial wall of the Slemm's canal, and then the surgical technique of trabeculotomy on either side. Probably the most important and the most demanding surgical step is exploration of the Slemm's canal. And that's the reason I am showing this video once again. You can see how beautifully it is going to the Slemm's canal and is going. I am showing the trabeculectomy part and then the closure of the incision. I'll conclude here and I'll invite, this is the child on which the technique was performed, and I just close my presentation, and any other issues or questions from any attendees.
Thank you so much Dr. Mandal. We now open it for panel discussion. We have about 10 minutes.
We have probably a couple of minutes, 7-8 minutes.
So we have 10 minutes.
10 minutes, very good. Excellent, enough time. Because the guest speaker has not joined, we had enough time. We have discussed in detail. Now, any question? No question. Everything is very clear. Sirisa. Sirisa, my question to you. Give you any tip for doing GATT procedure?
So I think at this point in time, I haven't done GATT in purely congenital glaucoma, very anterior, but I personally, I do a goniotomy if the cornea is clear.
All right.
But GATT I have done in children also, but
along with cataract surgery, you have done GATT?
Sphagitic glaucoma do very well.
All right. About double blade, you have experience, Kanusha?
Yes, along with cataract surgeries, I have been GATT. And GATT also independently. So most of these patients either have a primary, so that means they are, let's say, young patients who have a secondary or a primary open angle glaucoma. Or even elderly patients. In fact, I've also done it in patients where a previous TRAB has failed, and a couple of our colleagues have done it even when a primary tube has failed. And today we had a couple of patients where a post vitreoretinal surgery. So any condition where you have open angles, so you have a trabecular resistance. So that is what you're looking at. So whether it is steroid-induced glaucoma, uveitic with open angles, primary or secondary open angle glaucomas, these people do well. These people do well because, and especially if you have a risk, don't have any other procedure. We had a patient this morning in the clinic, the encircling band, and a pre and now the second intervention is required. So definitely here to stay, and these conditions.
All right. Sirisa, your voice is breaking. All right. Shati, any comments?
Nothing as such, sir.
Especially after you.
I can see here participants 11. Any of the, apart from our speakers, any other participants have any query? Dr. Das, can you unmute and...
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
So, first, absolutely fine. So nice, sir, to see you.
Sir, any comments on congenital glaucoma, surgery on congenital glaucoma, periotic glaucoma, any tips, any pearls?
I will certainly participate in it, but I'm not seen actually.
All right.
I just joined.
All right.
But there's a lot to learn from you, always.
From everybody, we learn from each other.
And that, but thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right. So I think we conclude here. Thank you, Sati, Sirisa, Devasis. We had a wonderful session on surgical treatment, recent advances, and of course, the contemporary techniques. We conclude here. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all the speakers again. Thank you so much for being a part of this session and making it so insightful.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Y'all may leave the meeting and we start the next session in the next 10 minutes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.